One with an uncontrolled mind cannot have spiritual intelligence. One devoid of spiritual intelligence never meditates on the ultimate truth. And for one who never meditates on ultimate truth, there is no peace. For one destitute, there is the happiness. Hello dear friends, I welcome all of you on the behalf of Vivekananda Samiti. Today we are here to learn about the secret of concentration as per Bhagavad Gita by our own Swamiji, Swami Sarvapriyananda Maharaj. Before starting our today's session, let me have a glance on the recent activities organized by Vivekananda Samiti. In January, we had Vivekananda Youth Leadership Convention. Under that, we had talks by various eminent personalities, namely Paramveer Chakra Bana Singh, Jal Purush Rajendra Singh, Ms. Arunima Sinha, Ms. Bhakti Sharma. There was various workshops on enlightened citizenship, school events, college events, followed by community services, and then Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose Jayanti, Sanskrit Shivir, weekly discussions on Vedanta, and now 3-day lecture series on Vedanta, which will feature lecture on secret on concentration as per Bhagavad Gita, Who Am I according to Mandukya Upanishad, part 1 on 1st March, that is tomorrow. On 2nd March, there will be a workshop on stress-free living techniques and Who Am I according to Mandukya Upanishad, part 2 by Swami Sarvapriyanandaji Maharaj. Let me remind you that Swamiji visited us in August 2012, and his lectures were very well received, and we got overwhelming response on YouTube link with 190,000 views across the globe. Swami Sarvapriyanandaji Maharaj is a dynamic young monk of Ramakrishna Math. He joined Ramakrishna Order at Ramakrishna Mission Vidyapith, Deoghar, Jharkhand in 1994. Since then, he has served the Ramakrishna Mission in various capacities, including Vice Principal of Deoghar Vidyapith Higher Secondary School, Principal of Sikshana Mandir Teacher Training College at Belur, and as the first Registrar of Ramakrishna Mission Vivekananda University at Belur. At present, he is an Acharya at the Monastic Probationers Training Center at Belur. He holds a degree in Business Management from Xavier Institute of Management, Bhubaneswar, and his interests are in the fields of spirituality, philosophy, management science, and education. On the occasion of 150th birth anniversary of Swami Vivekananda, he traveled many places of India and abroad and inspired thousands of people with his eloquent speech. And now I request Swamiji to please come on the dais, because we want to felicitate him with a token of gratitude.
Thank you.
The strength and force of the blow come through concentration. There is no limit to power of human mind. The more concentrated it is, the more power it brought to bear on one point. And that is the secret. Here is the difference between man and animal. Man has greater power of concentration. The difference in their power of concentration also constitutes difference between man and man. Compare the lowest with highest man, the difference is in the degree of concentration. And this is the only difference. Concentration is the essence of all knowledge. Nothing can be done without it. And now I request Swamiji to enlighten us with his views on the secret of concentration as per the.
Good evening. I'm audible to all of you? Very good. So it's great to be back here once again. I was here year before last. And just like last time, we're going to have 3 lectures. The first lecture will be of general interest, and the next 2 will be focused on Vedanta. In the first lecture this year, I thought I'll select something that is of interest to everybody, and especially students in this institute. The power of concentration. I think almost everybody would like to increase his or her power of concentration. And there is actually a lot to be learned from our ancient scriptures, especially the Gita and Patanjali Yoga Sutras. So we'll take some learning from there this evening and also combine it with some advances which have been made in positive psychology over the last 20 to 30 years. In fact, a lot of interesting research has been done in the field of positive psychology, which I'll combine with our understanding of the teachings of Bhagavad Gita and Patanjali Yoga Sutras. The primary questions which we will deal with this evening are: what exactly happens in concentration? And that which is of interest to all of us, whether you are students or teachers or a monk, all of us, we would like to know how we can use this understanding to improve our own concentration. So let's go. I'll be using a lot of positive psychology, so let me tell you a little bit about what is this. What is this positive psychology? What has happened in the last 20 years or so is that there's a new branch of psychology which has become more and more popular across the world. It is academic psychology. It's not the kind of self-help books you find in bookshops across the world, which are very popular sections. You know, you all go there to learn many things, how to get rich in 7 days, or how to sleep better, or how to lose weight, or whatnot. But it's not like that. It is very rigorous academic psychology backed up by research. And the person who is a pioneer in this field, Professor Seligman, he put it very beautifully. He gave a talk on TED Talks. I think some of you follow it, TED, Technology Entertainment Design, TED.com. TED Talks, you can look him up, Seligman on TED Talks. And he gave an introduction to positive psychology there. And he started off so beautifully, I cannot resist telling you that that little story he said at the beginning of his talk. He said that he was interviewed by CNN. It's a story and actually did not happen. He was interviewed by CNN and they asked him, Professor Seligman, what is the state of psychology today? But this is CNN, so you cannot give a long speech. You have to give be very brief. So this old professor, he said, okay, how much time will you give me? One word. So what is the state of psychology today? He said, good. What else to say? Good. Cut. No, this is not enough. Little more explanation is required. Two words. Professor Seligman, what is the state of psychology today? And he said, not good. You're taken aback. Just now you said it is good, now you're saying it is not good. Can you explain little more? Three words. And Professor Seligman, what is the state of psychology today? He said, not good enough. And then he explains very beautifully. Mostly psychology has been concerned with illness, mental illness, disabilities, schizophrenia, paranoia, and so many things. How to identify these illnesses and how to cure them. And in that sense, it is good. But not good in the sense that it has, what does it have to give ordinary people like us? We are not sick enough to go to a psychiatrist or to a mental hospital. But how can it improve our lives? Psychology has not done much for that. And therefore, he says, how can psychology become good enough? And that's why he went for this positive psychology. What is positive psychology? It's basically research into human strengths. Not just human illness and weaknesses, but into human strengths. Happiness, character, and concentration also. So one of the areas of positive psychology which we will use today is concentration. And the person who has worked in this area is the second name there. And if you learn how to pronounce his name, that's it. That itself is an achievement for this evening. If you learn how to spell the name and pronounce it, I'll tell you. It is Mihai Csikszentmihalyi. Mihai Csikszentmihalyi. It's of Eastern European origin. He has worked in this area for more than 30 years. 30 years in the United States. And his talk is also there on TED Talks. So if you can look it up. Mihai Csikszentmihalyi, about flow. And he is not as entertaining a speaker as Professor Seligman. He is very slow and quiet, but he's very profound, so you can learn a lot of things from his talk. Anyhow, the basic ideas I have extracted from the talk, I will be presenting it here along with yoga and the Gita. What he has concentrated upon is how to enrich our life. He says the quality of our life depends upon the quality of our experience. I'll repeat that again. The quality of our day-to-day, minute-to-minute experience of life, what we are experiencing now. The better the quality of that, better we feel our life is. So the quality of my life depends upon the quality of my experience. And his basic thesis is, the quality of experience, on what does it depend? He says it depends on concentration, on focus, on attention. And that's what he has tried to establish. So I will put that in this talk, and we'll see what we can learn from that. This is Mihai Csikszentmihalyi. I took this picture from his TED Talks. And this is the book. He has written a number of books, but this book is really good. All the books are good, I'm sorry. But this book is, it deals with his central theme, his work. And the book is Flow, the Psychology of Optimal Experience. Nowadays, it's very easy. I think your library may have a copy. And if not, getting it on Flipkart is, of course, very easy. He calls it flow. And where did he get this word? He says he was once interviewing a music composer, one who composes and conducts orchestral music. So that in that interview, he asked that composer, what is the best part of your experience, your day-to-day experience? When are you happiest? When are you achieving the most? What do you feel at that time? And that composer, he said this. He says, when I'm composing, you feel you are in an ecstatic state to such a point that you feel as though you almost don't exist. You don't exist almost. I have experienced this time and again. My hand seems devoid of myself and I have nothing to do with what is happening. I just sit there watching it in a state of awe and wonderment, and the music just flows out of itself. He's conducting some musical thing, and he says, my hand is almost as if it is moving by itself. That is the highest state of performance which he has experienced. And this is nothing very amazing, you know. It is something that we have all experienced. Especially in a place like this, in an IIT, in IIT Kanpur, many, if not all of you, you would have experienced it while studying, while doing research. To some extent, all of you would have experienced it. A time when you are completely absorbed in your work, whether you are reading something or doing research in a lab or whatever, you're completely absorbed in your work. It's tough, it's demanding, but you know, there's a flow to it. Sometimes you see there's no flow to it. You're struggling. And sometimes you feel bored. I mean, you're not struggling, but it's very too easy and you know what you're doing and it's mechanical. But sometimes there's a flow which comes. This is the word which he has used, flow. And we'll investigate that further. This is important. This is where he begins. Don't take these figures too literally. I'm sure those who are doing research can come up with better figures. But basically what he has done here is, he says, Csikszentmihalyi, he says, our cognitive capacity is limited. We don't have infinite cognitive capacity. We have limited cognitive capacity. And he uses the terms of information technology, IT, to sort of estimate what could be our cognitive capacity. And his estimate is like this. He says, we can more or less, roughly, process 7 bits in the sense of computer bits, you know, computer information technology bits, 7 bits of information at a time. And it takes 1 by 18th of a second, he says, to discriminate between 2 bits of information. Basic idea, only one figure you need to take away from this. He says, approximately, our capacity to absorb information from the world outside by seeing, hearing, whatever, is 126 bits per second. 126 bits per second, that is our capacity to absorb information. And if you calculate it, it comes to some 7,560 bits per minute, 500,000 bits per hour. And if you stay awake for 16 hours a day, so it's about 185 billion bits in a 70-year lifespan, and so on and so forth. It seems to be very big. But actually, he says, this is very limited. This is very limited. Actually, he says, this is very limited. our capacity to process information is actually very limited. And he gives an example. He says that you are listening to me now, and out of that 126 bits of informational processing capacity which we all have, out of that which you have, you are actually using up some 60 bits per second just to listen to me and understand what I am saying. That's why he says it's very difficult if two people speak to you at the same time. If two people speak to you at the same time, you find it difficult to absorb, it's irritating also. And if three people speak to you at the same time, it's impossible. You cannot understand what each person is saying if you try to listen and understand. The reason is, at 60 bits per second, three people speaking to you would be 180 bits, which is beyond human capacity to absorb and assimilate. Therefore, he says that this capacity, this is what we have. From moment to moment, second to second, this is the cognitive capacity each of us has, approximately. Don't take 126 bits as a given figure. It might be 150, it might be 100, I mean, it depends on how he's done the research. But the principle is, we have a very limited bandwidth. Okay, keep this in mind. So when in a school, the teacher shouts at the students, pay attention. It's literally true. Each student has 126 bits per second, which he or she can divide among the teacher and the classmates and many other things in the environment. So when the teacher says pay attention, he or she wants more of your 126 bits per second. This is the basic idea. What is concentration then? Defined by positive psychology by Csikszentmihalyi. Concentration is very simple. He says, how much of that 126 bits per second which you or I have, how much of that am I able to give to the object of concentration? 126 bits, how much of that can I give to the object of concentration? Can I give 80, 90, 100? You can't give all 126 bits, because at least you must be aware of your own existence. You're breathing, you're aware of the environment. To some basic environmental awareness is always there. So maybe 100, 110 bits you can give to the object of concentration. If you can do that, that's perfect concentration. Now, let's go ahead. He has studied the features of flow, and he comes to certain characteristics of flow. Flow, remember, is a state of concentration, deep concentration on the object of concentration. It may be studying, you may be playing, you may be listening to music or singing or whatever. Any activity which absorbs an overwhelming part of that 126 bits per second. He says, it requires a challenging activity, and where there must be some skills which you have developed over the years. So he gives an example that the conductor who he spoke about composing music, he says, my hands move by themselves in flow. So that hands move by themselves requires years and years of dedicated practice. If you or I try to do that, our hands will not move by themselves, nothing will happen. So it requires building up a lot of practice, a high level of skill. Then you challenge that skill and flow will come. A difficult activity for which you are prepared, that can lead to flow. It comes to players, it comes to athletes, it comes to scholars. When you are doing research in the lab, when you are studying in the library. So that is flow. Then he says, merging of action and awareness. This is very important. The work which you are doing, or the game which you are playing, whatever, and your consciousness, they seem to be fully merged and submerged in that. Swami Vivekananda here says, when one works with concentration, losing all consciousness of oneself, the work that is done will be infinitely better. He says, if the painter, losing the consciousness of his ego, becomes completely immersed in his painting, he will be able to produce masterpieces. One thing we have all noticed and heard about, and in this institute you must be seeing this on a daily basis, the scientist or the scholar who gets so absorbed in his or her work seems to forget about himself or herself. We have all heard the stories of the mad scientist who is working in a laboratory and forgets to eat and forgets to go home. We have this Swami who is a mathematician, who's an alumnus of IIT Kanpur. He got the Bhatnagar Award last year. He's a monk in the order, and he tells me stories of well-known mathematicians sometimes. There was this Norbert Wiener, mathematician, who it seems that he he had changed his apartment one day, and he went to the college, he was university, he was teaching or doing research, and he came back and he had forgotten where they had shifted to, from one apartment to another apartment. The family had shifted, but he had forgotten where they had gone to. So he came back to his old apartment, he was standing there. He knew that, you know, we have shifted, but where we went to, that new apartment, he has forgotten. Then he saw a little girl standing in front of the apartment, and he said, "My dear, do you know where these people who is to stay here, which apartment they have shifted to, do you know?" And the little girl said, "Yes, Daddy, Mummy knew you would forget, so she has sent me to..." So not only has forgotten the apartment, he's forgotten his daughter also. That happens because out of that 126 bits, such a great amount is absorbed in the work that everything else is blanked out, it's forgotten. And that's why, you know, when you are studying, many of you study with great concentration for long periods of time, you forget that you're exhausted. You forget that, you know, you have not eaten. The reason is that 126 bits is not enough to accommodate the object which you are focusing it on and your personal discomfort also. There's no space left over for that. You are not aware of it. Afterwards, when you finish, you will feel exhausted and hungry and tired and so on and so forth. So, merging of your small consciousness, it's forgotten. Because simply there's no space to be aware. I am hungry, time to go and eat. There's no cognitive surplus to think about that. Then you come to the Gita, and Swami Vivekananda says, what does the Gita say? The Gita teaches that all work should be done thus. The way you are doing work in the lab or studying, Krishna teaches Arjuna, do every work in this way. Being united with God, or your true spiritual nature, whatever you call it, the Atman, God or whatever, through yoga you are united with your spiritual nature. Based on that, perform all action by becoming immersed in concentration, and add to that, there is no self-seeking. There are certain things which are here, which you will not find, they have not yet studied in positive psychology. For example, when there is too much focus on the result, I want something from this, then somehow it prevents concentration. I think it's somewhere in an interview, Sachin Tendulkar says, secrets of batting, he says, when I really want to do well, I don't look at the scoreboard. I focus on the game, but I consciously avoid looking at the scoreboard. Especially when I'm close to a century, I consciously avoid looking at the scoreboard. Because at that moment, however much you want to concentrate on the game, the feeling will come that now I must score, just a few more runs, I'll get the 100. And that's when most batsmen get out, they get bowled out. So somehow, seeking the result seems to create a division in consciousness, seems to prevent full consciousness, full concentration, seems to prevent your ability to put as much as you want of that 126 bits into the object of concentration. And Swami Vivekananda says, such a performance of work brings only good to the world, no evil can come out of it, mainly because I think there is no self-seeking involved in that. Those who work thus never do anything for themselves. They may do it for science, or they may do it for welfare of others, whatever. But not this small individual self, which is forgotten in concentration. Another thing positive psychology says is necessary for concentration, for flow, is clear goals and feedback. So, in the work which you do, studying or whatever, you must have some kind of clear idea where you are going. Many people who do research, they tell me, that's precisely what is research. We don't know what we are doing. That's why we call it research. But yes, there is an element of the unknown. But the thing which you are doing at particular moment, you must have clarity what you are doing and what you are trying to do. May not be about the whole thing where you are moving into the unknown. So a clear goal, and there must be some feedback. Here I want to add something. Often in research, there is a long period where you don't get any clear feedback. Nothing is happening. See, I'll tell you a little story. Last week, I had gone to the Vivekananda University, which is just outside Belur, where that Swami I told you about, the mathematician Swami, who works there in the mathematics department there. So I had gone for tea around this time. And he came for tea too. We were sitting and having tea, and he said that I'm in the middle of a class, And his class is like, it starts at 8 o'clock in the morning. He said, I've started at 8. I said, 8? Did you break for lunch? No. You're the only teacher, yes. And the same set of students, yes. And when will you end? 8 or 10 in the night? So 10, 12, 14 hours, one class. Yes, one class. Of course, it's problem solving. It's not that he's lecturing all the time. Then I asked him why. And he said something very interesting. He said, you see, in research, for most of the time, the default value is zero. For a long period of time, the gain you will get in research is nothing. Nothing will be seen to be happening. If you're doing genuine research for a long time, for, he says that these boys who are working in the class now, for they will have to hold on for days, weeks, months, even years. You know that person who solved the Fermat's theorem? Andrew Wiley, whatever. He took more than 10 years. He was working in private, apart from his job, secretly he was working. And through all sorts of frustrations. I read the book on that. I don't understand any of the mathematics. But luckily, the person who wrote the book also said at the very beginning, I also don't understand the mathematics. I'm going to tell this human story of that person. But the point to be understood there is, for a long time in research, you will not get any positive value. And for that period of time that these boys have to hold on, they have to learn how to struggle for hours throughout the day, for days and weeks and months throughout the year, and maybe for years together. If they don't have that patience, then they cannot be good researchers. So one point about this, you know, when you say feedback, it's true, feedback helps in flow, but sometimes you may not have feedback, and there also that grit is necessary to hold on to the concentration without the feedback also, without positive feedback. And concentration. Fourth characteristic of flow is concentration itself, where there is tremendous focus. One sign of concentration is you forget all other problems in life. It is true. You may have lots of problems. Problems at home, health-related issues, maybe issues related to career, what not. Even issues related to the environment where you are working. But if you get flow at that time, you tend to forget all it. This is one of the characteristics of concentration. Now, why do you forget? The answer is again simple. Because you don't have more than 126 bits per second. So your mind will not dwell on those things if you put most of it into the object of concentration. So this tremendous focus, Swami Vivekananda says, to me the very essence of education is concentration of mind, not the collecting of facts. The difference between an ordinary person and a great person lies in the degree of concentration. And you know, when I read this long ago, I read this from Swami Vivekananda, I was not very convinced, because I used to think that difference between an ordinary person and a great person lies in so many dimensions of human personality. Why only concentration? One day, I had a revelation. I saw another Swami, who is also an alumni of IIT Kanpur. Long back, he joined the order long back. He was studying. Studying means just relaxing on the bed, with leg spread out in front, sitting and reading a book. I came in front of him and I asked him in Hindi, Maharaj ji, kya padh rahe hain? What are you reading? No answer, he's reading. I'm standing in front of him. He cannot see me. He's reading. I asked him again, no answer. I bent forward and you know, his foot was spread out in front, his leg was spread out in front and his foot and his big toe. I caught hold of that and shook it. What are you reading? You won't believe it. He did not feel it. The focus he has in the book is so much. Now you understand, 126 bits, maybe 120 bits is on that book. He cannot feel somebody touching him. When I stepped forward and I just raised the book to see the title, he got a shock. Which means such tremendous focus. There are so many stories about Swami Vivekananda, of course. Those who have read his life, they know that how in Belur Math, where he used to stay, his disciple Sharat Chandra one day came upon him reading the Encyclopedia Britannica in those days. Nowadays, if I say Encyclopedia Britannica, somebody is reading it, most of the students, just like you all, you know, they say, oh, okay, could be. What's so great about it? Because you see, nowadays Encyclopedia Britannica is one DVD. But if you see the old set, yeah, huge. They used to, and earlier in those days, there used to be these leather-bound volumes. So I heard when the set would arrive in the library, they would strengthen the shelves of the library with wooden planks so that it will not bend, you know, catenary it will become. So that set is there, and Swami Vivekananda is reading it, and this disciple comes and asks, Swamiji, so many books, fat books, it's impossible for a human being to finish it in one lifetime. And Swamiji said, what are you saying? I have gone through 9 volumes and I'm on the 10th volume, you can ask me anything from the 9 volumes. It's a story, well-known story. And Sharatchandra actually, he went and picked up books at random and he asked questions at random, and Swamiji answered all of that in this, he says, in some places, the exact language down to the comma and the full stop also. That was fantastic. And he asked Swami Vivekananda, how is this possible? And Swamiji said, with concentration and purity, one can do it and anybody can do it. Everybody has this capacity. So Swami Vivekananda says the difference between an ordinary person and a great person lies in the degree of concentration. This is the symbol of the Ramakrishna Mission. Swami Vivekananda designed it. And many of you may know the meaning. I'll just tell you in a couple of sentences. Basic idea is that the sun which is rising at the back represents knowledge. The wavy waters represent work. The lotus represents bhakti, devotion. And the snake encircling all of it represents concentration, meditation. So by a combination of knowledge, work, devotion and concentration or meditation, one realizes the swan there represents the Paramatman, God, spiritual reality, whatever you call it. So spiritual reality is realized by a combination of karma yoga, work, spiritualized work, jnana yoga, the path of knowledge, bhakti yoga, the path of devotion, and raja yoga, the path of meditation. Okay, this is the basic idea. But why I have put it here is for the snake alone. The snake represents meditation, concentration, and Swami Vivekananda writes in one place, the meaning of the symbol is this, and the snake, the serpent, represents concentration. It is so interesting, I was going through this book, it's a recent book called Rapt. Rapt as in attention, immersed in something. And this author, this lady, Winifred Gallagher, she's done research on attention and she's written this book. In one place she says, she has no connection with Ramakrishna Mission, she does not know any of these things, I think so at least. She says, the best symbol I can think about for concentration is this cobra with a, you know, with its hood, its expanded hood. Best symbol. I was amazed, you know, this is the exact same idea which Swami Vivekananda puts forward as a symbol for concentration. And why is it so? Because she says, all the elements, central elements of concentration are here. This is one lesson we must take away from here. What are the central elements? Just remember this, the picture of this snake. First of all, a mental bearing down on a subject. What does the cobra do when it's going to eat a rat or a frog? Like a bearing down, you know, tremendous focus on that. So mental bearing down on a subject, the book or the instrument or work which you are doing, focusing the mind on that, mental bearing down on the subject. Second, the hood flaring to block out all distractions. The hood of the cobra flaring to block out all distractions. Of course, the cobra does not flare the hood to block out distractions or anything like that, but this is the meaning which we are giving to it. Have you noticed how little children study? Why little children? And last year I was in, year before last, I was in IIT Kanpur, I was in the library. I saw many of the boys and girls there studying, and they also do the same thing. You have noticed how they study, or how you, many of you study? Like this? Book is there, like this. What are you doing there? Unconsciously, you're basically cutting out the world. So that's another part of concentration. You are pulling out as much of the 126 bits per second which is scattered here and there, you're pulling it out basically and putting it here. So it's very natural. This hood flaring to block out distractions and holding steady in your unblinking focus. A few seconds of that anybody can manage. Couple of minutes of that anybody can manage. But hours and hours and hours of that, holding steady in your unblinking focus. These are the three elements. Engage your mind, pull out the bits you have scattered all over in your life, you know, different subjects in your life. You pull it out and pour it here and hold it. Like that mathematician Swami, 8 hours, 10 hours, 12 hours on one problem. I was joking with him, you know, did you leave the students for lunch break? He said, no. I said, they'll faint. He said, okay, once they recover consciousness, they can do maths again. Along with this, one more point, which is not mentioned as yet by Csikszentmihalyi or positive psychology, but Swami Vivekananda insists on this. He says, along with the development of concentration, we must develop the power of detachment. We must learn not only to attach the mind to one thing exclusively, but also to detach it at a moment's notice and place it on something else. You see, many of you have good concentration, otherwise you wouldn't be here. But there's an ability that if you can pull your mind out from one thing and then put it totally into another thing, that's a tremendous ability. It seems, I read in Napoleon's life once, you know, he could do so many things at a time. Writing letters back to Paris about the construction of bridges, writing about the new financial system, writing letters about the direction of the military forces in battle, and so on and so forth. Writing to his wife, Josephine. Somebody asked him, how do you do all that? And he said, see, I have this cabinet. This was time before computers came. So I have this cabinet in my mind, drawers. So when I want to talk about, when I want to work on the army, I open that drawer and shut all other drawers. When I want to talk about finances, I shut the other drawers and open the drawer about the finances, and so forth. And when I shut all the drawers, I go off to sleep. He had the ability to go to sleep anytime he wanted. Now that's a tremendously organized mind. But it shows the structure of the mind. It matches with what we have been studying here. And Swami Vivekananda, this is a famous quotation. Education is concentration of mind. If I had to do my education all over again and had any voice in the matter, I would not study facts at all. I would develop the power of concentration and detachment, and then with a perfect instrument, I could collect facts at will. Another aspect of flow is feeling in control. If you know, so a person who's playing tabla and he gets flow, anybody who plays musical instruments, sometime or the other he would have felt it, musical instruments or singing. So sometimes you know you are in flow. And you must know how to play that instrument pretty well. There must be a sense of control. If you don't know what you are doing, you'll never get flow. It'll just be straining. It'll be tension and strain. Loss of self-awareness, we spoke about this. We'll just leave this one out for the time being. Another aspect is transformation of time. Again, we have experienced this. There's a time distortion. When you are in flow, hours seem to pass by very quickly. You know, when you look up and you see the clock, and you find that already 2 or 3 hours have gone. You don't feel that you have been sitting there for 2 or 3 hours. That is the nature of flow. With deep concentration, time seems to fly. If you don't have deep concentration, then time seems to drag. I have often, you know, I was talking to some students in a college somewhere else. And I was speaking about the way I saw the boys and girls in the IIT Kanpur library studying. And I said, see, they, you know, on Sundays they come, and I saw some of them studying from the morning till afternoon till night. Sometimes they do all night, they're studying, not just one or two. Many of them, they do that. Especially I heard before examinations, a lot of you are up and doing. Obviously, you have to. Now, one of them said, one of the boys was sitting there, he said, how boring. I said, no, it's not boring. In fact, if you like the subject, and if you're immersed in it, and if you cut away everything else in life, then it's not boring actually. Because when you get the flow, flow is very enjoyable. It's deeply satisfying. Of course, because you have an exam and you have to get grades and all, it's tension. But otherwise, it's deeply satisfying. You know what is boring? What is difficult? If you give only a part of that 126 bits, maybe 50 bits and 60 bits, and the rest of it is still free, then you can think about the good time you could be having watching TV or playing video games, and you're still doing physics, and then you feel how boring and irritating this is. Or, you know, you're sitting and the same kid who sits and watches a cricket match for hours together, he does not complain about how hot it is, how mosquitoes are biting him, does not complain. But the moment you put that kid in front of his homework, he'll say, kaise padhe, garmi hai, machar hai, how can I study? What happens is, because out of that 126 bits, almost all of it is absorbed on the cricket match, he does not feel the discomfort of heat or mosquitoes or whatever. But when he's doing something he does not like it, most of his cognitive capacity is free, and it will go to whatever pulls his cognitive capacity, you know, like it may be a mosquito, whatever. I remember when we meditate in Belur Math, so this mosquitoes have a free reign, you know, and especially when you are meditating, you can't do anything about the mosquito. Even one mosquito can spoil your meditation. And sometimes I've seen other monks and what they do early in the morning, so they'll have this chadar, you open it and put a sort of cloth here, like a veil, so that the mosquito can't enter. And if one mosquito enters that, then you are in deep trouble. It'll be like somebody is fighting in that, you will see. And I was reading of Swami Vivekananda, Girish Ghosh, the famous dramatist, he narrates how he saw Swami Vivekananda sitting in meditation and his face is black, covered with mosquitoes. He does not feel it. He's gone deep within so much that nothing is left over. Of course, he'll feel it when he comes out. Maybe face will be swollen with mosquito bites. But at that moment, he does not feel it. So this is exactly what happens to us in a lesser degree maybe when you are studying or working on something that absorbs most of your cognitive capacity. If you are studying without that flow, without that concentration, it's much more strenuous. Then every few minutes you will feel like going and having a coffee break or going and taking a walk, whatever. Because there is that excess cognitive surplus left over which will remind you are suffering, you are doing something boring, please get up. When that is not free, you have a very good time actually. You have forgotten. Time moves faster. Time moves slower, of course. Both are interesting. One surgeon was telling me how hours, 6-7 hours they have to do this neurosurgery. 6-7 hours. I said, how is it possible? Such concentration for such a long time. He says, I don't feel I'm doing it for 5 or 6 hours. After the operation is over, I'd see it's 5 or 6 hours. So time has moved very fast. Just the opposite, I heard from a fighter pilot. I was sitting in the airport and this gentleman is a retired Air Force pilot. He's not retired, but he's in the Air Force now. At one time he was a fighter pilot and he was telling me how he ejected from a plane which was crashing. And he spoke to the air traffic control, gave a mayday call and he's saying that I'm ejecting at such and such position. And he says, I was feeling irritated at that moment. Why is the traffic control, air traffic control, the military air traffic control, why are they taking so much time to respond to me? I'm in an emergency here, seconds count. Later on, when the court of inquiry, they have a board of inquiry after the crash, there he saw, they were laughing at him. They said that we responded within a second or 2 seconds, but for you, time seems to be dilated. Because at the time, at a point of death, you know, you could die at that moment. Every fraction of a second seems to be living, and it's stretched out and dilated. So when you are in flow, both effects are possible, but the common thing is a distortion of time takes place. So these are the characteristics of flow. Quickly let me run through it. You feel completely involved in what you are doing, focused and concentrated. Second, happiness, sense of ecstasy in any kind of flow. Chikzen Mihai interviewed people who were scholars, who were athletes, who were musicians, even monks and nuns who were meditating, all of them, whatever the diverse activities, but wherever they found flow, he found joy. They feel happy, being outside everyday reality, ecstasy. Great inner clarity. Moment to moment, you know what has to be done, and you are doing it, and you're fully absorbed in it. And fourth, knowing that activity is doable, your skill is adequate to the task, but challenged. A sense of serenity, you have no feeling, no worries about yourself. An intrinsic motivation, whatever produces flow becomes its own reward. See, people who get flow in music or study or whatever, they tend to repeat it. They tend to do it more and more. They like it. Other people may find it very difficult. They will say, bhaiya, aap 24 ghante padhai kiye, itna boring ho sakta hai. It's not boring for you. Then timelessness, you're thoroughly focused on the there's a spelling mistake there. On the present, hours seem to pass by in minutes. If there is anything that I would like you to take away from this talk, this is it. This is the central finding of positive psychology about concentration. Let me walk you through this diagram. Then we'll relate it to yoga and conclude. But this is central. What does it say? Basic idea is, if you want to attain concentration, there are these two dimensions you have to take care of. One is your skills, whatever the activity, your capability. and the second one is the challenge facing you. So he takes the example of a tennis player who is a beginner. So when you are beginning tennis, when we start playing, it's just a great thing just to return a serve. You can't do much more than that. And if you play against a state champion or a national champion, then what happens? The challenge is too much. Skills are very low. And the result is you have worry or anxiety. You can't face it, it's too much. A teacher who is teaching maybe something, differential equation or something, first time he goes into class, is a new teacher, maybe an assistant teacher. His skills, teaching skills are not all that great, and he's facing a class for the first time, and challenge is pretty high. Here are IIT students. So he feels worry or anxiety. But as his skills improve, as the tennis players practices or the teacher keeps on teaching, what happens is his skills improve, challenge remains the same, and this comes down. This anxiety becomes, you know, arousal in the sense that he is ready to face the challenge, and then it comes to flow. It is equal. Here is a challenge, here is a channel where skills and challenges are matched. Now the tennis player, he can return the serve and he feels happy. When he returns the serve, he feels happy. He gets a tiny bit of flow at that point. So there is a channel here where your challenges and skills are matched. If your skills are pretty high and the challenge is low, skills are pretty high, you are a state champion in tennis and you just have to do net practice, then it's very, very easy for you, mechanical, and you feel apathetic. There is no response inside. It's too easy for you. Or you feel bored. And as your challenge increases, you come back to flow. Now you see this entire spread. Here is the desirable channel when you have flow. If you see the teacher who is teaching for some time, he gets the hang of it. Now he starts enjoying the class because he can teach well and the class is also enjoying it and he gets the feeling of flow. After some time, what happens? After a couple of years or 2-3 years, it's in control. Without putting too much effort into it, he can manage the class. The tennis player can manage the game also without too much effort. After some time, what happens is he gets relaxed about it and maybe even bored. There he requires higher challenges to enter into flow. The basic idea, the crucial idea, the point of flow, the channel of flow also is dynamic. As your skills keep on improving, you must increase the challenge also to be in flow. And the fundamental fact behind it is that 126 bits, you must put as much of it as possible into that activity. So if your skills are very high, challenge is very low, you need not put 126 bits into that. With some amount of cognitive capacity, you can manage. But that leaves the rest unutilized. So to have flow, to have concentration, you require a dynamic equilibrium between the challenge you are facing and the skills. And what is the learning for us? What is the learning? What do you take away from it? It's pretty obvious. If you want to be in flow, you must look at your situation. Are you here? Do you find the courses too demanding, the classes too tough? Then you must reduce the challenge and work up your skills. How do you do that? You know. You maybe have to parse the subject matter into smaller bits, which you can focus at a time. Maybe you need to get help from your seniors or your professor. Many ways in which you can build up your skills and at the same time reduce the challenge by taking it into smaller bits, parsing the material into smaller bits. The opposite, are you feeling bored in a class? Are you feeling bored in a course? Then increase the challenge. I remember once, Swami, we were attending a class together in Belur Math, and I found the class boring. And I found this other person sitting next to me taking extensive notes. And I knew this person is brilliant, he's far more brilliant than me. For him, this course is nothing. But why is he taking such extensive notes? When I looked closely, you know what he was doing? The teacher was teaching, the acharya was teaching in English. And this brother, this novice, he was taking notes, perfect notes in Sanskrit. He was translating that into Sanskrit and taking down perfect notes. Why? Because he was bored. He knew all of it. So what will he do? He has to sit in the class. There's a discipline. So how does he get let flow? He's not using this, but very naturally he is using this. He immediately upped the challenge. He pushed the challenge up very high. So he's listening, translating into Sanskrit, and believe me, it's not easy. We had a teacher who used to teach in Sanskrit only. And I remember, anytime you have to ask a question, you have to ask a question in Sanskrit, otherwise he will not respond. And if you ask a question in Sanskrit, you know, if you put together grammatically, it must be correct. By the time I ask the question, he will find out two or three grammatical errors in my question, and then he go on teaching again. He will not come to the answer. It's unless you ask a perfectly correct question, grammatically correct, I will not answer. It's not worth answering. So that's how he was getting flow. Okay, now we come to the final part of this. Csikszentmihalyi, in that book, Flow, Psychology of Optimal Experience, he says the similarities between yoga and flow are very strong. He has a whole few pages on yoga, on Patanjali yoga. He has studied literatures from all over the world, and he says in that book, the similarities between yoga, Patanjali yoga, and flow are very strong. And he calls yoga a very thoroughly planned flow activity. In fact, he says one of the oldest and most systematic methods of getting flow is this Indian system of yoga, he says that. Now, I'm not going to teach you yoga now, but I'll give you the basics of yoga and how we can use it for attaining concentration and flow. That'll be my final point. Okay. What does yoga say? To get perfect concentration, according to yoga, there are 8 steps. 8 steps. Yama and Niyama, these are preliminary disciplines. Asana, posture. Pranayama, breathing. Pratyahara, withdrawing from the external world. Dharana, focusing on a topic. And Dhyana, meditation or unbroken focus. And finally, the highest possible concentration, Samadhi. Remember, this is not the point of this is not flow. The point, the yogis use this for spiritual realization. But they do get flow. Now, in fact, I was reading one of the disciples of Sri Ramakrishna. He's talking about meditation. When you get good meditation, he says, it should be effortless. And one of the characteristics of flow is effortlessness. Before flow, there is effort. When challenge is more, skill is not so high. Then you get into an effortless mode, which is flow. If the skills are high and challenges are low, even there is effortlessness, but there's no flow because you are bored then. So when you have flow, there's effortlessness. Okay. Now how do you use this for flow? Yama and Niyama would be, Yama would be a moral life, a clean life. That's important. Yama and Niyama specifically, a disciplined life. Rhythm is necessary in life for generating concentration and focus. There's a story about Sedji who went to a Swami in the Himalayas. Humko dhyan sikhaiye, yog sikhaiye. And the Swami started, all right, very good, sit down. First, satya, you have to tell the truth. Ahimsa, you should not hurt anybody. Brahmacharya, self-control, yama. Then the Sedji got disgusted. I said, are Mahatma ji, humko dhyan sikhaiye, pranayam, asan, pranayam, dhyan sikhaiye, kya sach bolna hai, jhoot nahi bolna hai, ye sab kya sikha rahe hai humko? Then that Swami said, तुम अष्टांग योग सीखोगे या विकलांग योग सीखोगे? अष्टांग इज 8 limbed एंड विकलांग मीन्स 2 limbs आर नॉट देयर. यू वॉन्ट टू रिमूव मॉरेलिटी एंड डिसिप्लिन फ्रॉम योर लाइफ, जस्ट वॉन्ट मेडिटेशन. दैट इज नॉट अष्टांग योग, दैट्स विकलांग योग. इट्स नॉट पॉसिबल. एंड देन दैट स्वामी टोल्ड दैट बिजनेस मैन, इट्स अ स्टोरी, ही सेड दैट ब्लैक मनी पर आसन बिछा के ध्यान होगा. You've got lots of black money which you've hidden under your bed and you put an asana on top of you and sit for meditation. Dhyana hoga kabhi? Never. So, a certain amount of morality, a moral life first, a disciplined life second, then third. What is required for flow? Third, asana. Asana need not mean that you have to sit in Padmasana or whatever. It simply means posture. What posture? They have found that sitting straight, not rigid, not like a, you know, like a robot and a savdhan, not like that. Relaxed but straight, where the head and the neck and the spine, the chest and the waist and the spine are more or less in one straight line. Relaxed, but not drooping. You can see the difference it makes in your mental attitude when you more or less sit up straight. after you get flow, one may concentrate on, you know, your already mind is there. That's not important. But before that, good posture is important. Pranayam, there is a connection between breathing and concentration. Positive psychology, till today, they have not talked about it. It's an area, these are areas of research. But there is a connection. One thing you will notice, the kind of breathing when you are, you have when you are tired, when we feel tired and sleepy and dull, so one kind of breathing. Often you will see it comes from the left nostril. When you are excited, angry, or working physically, hard working, you know, physically doing something, then right nostril, when you're jogging or playing, you'll see most of the time breathing comes from the right nostril. And they say in perfect, in concentration, breathing will come slowly from both nostrils. Anyhow, you need not go into all that, but basically breathing, just some amount of deep breathing helps. Even physiologically it makes sense if you oxygenate your blood and all, concentration is better. Then pratyahara, withdrawing your cognitive capacities from the world outside. Remember the snake with the hood, cutting out the world, pratyahara, not thinking of other things. And here you need to be a little intelligent. Suppose I'm concentrating, many times school students say this, if I look at my book and try to concentrate, I fall asleep. Or I'm looking at the book, half an hour later, if you ask me, what have you read? I can tell you, my mind went all over the world, but I cannot tell you what was there in the page in front of me. So many are smiling and think it's a common problem. But not so much here. Many of you have good concentration. So here you have to be a little intelligent. Pratyahara, withdrawing the mind from the world outside, even from your own body, you take the help of, for example, active reading. You know what is active reading? You underline. Take notes. Maybe you will never need read the notes again. But use your hand. The moment you start using your hand, it takes some more of the cognitive capacity from the world outside and puts it there. Use a computer. Use feedback. Block out the noise. You know, in many ways, you can concentrate your mind. One very powerful way of concentration is curiosity. Curiosity. You can arouse curiosity. You know how powerful curiosity is. In a train, I saw a little baby crying. I know many of you have seen this. Child crying like anything. And when the mother or the father suddenly comes in front of the child and does like this, or gets some toy and swings it in front of the baby is screaming. But in front of that, suddenly some strange thing you put, stop screaming and look in wonder. At least for 1 minute, it will look like that. It will forget to cry. Curiosity is very powerful. And we also have that power. So how do you use curiosity? Maharaj, I don't want to read all these. Exams are there, that's why I read. I'm reading. I don't want to know also all these things. But you can artificially induce curiosity by asking questions or setting up a problem before you go into the material. Often what we do, a mistake we do is, read the material, then solve problems. But you set up a problem, then start reading the material, then it's a voyage of discovery. It's not just learning something which you will apply later on. So these are tricks which you can use to engage your cognitive capacities in the study material. So pratyahara has to be done intelligently. It should not be a struggle. Then dharana is focus. Dhyana, holding on to that focus. This pratyahara, I remember, Swami Ranganathanandaji, he used to come to IIT Kanpur campus long back, I think in the 70s maybe, or 60s. I have seen his books in our Belur Math library, the books he donated. He was a voracious reader. All of his books, you can easily know it is Ranganathanandaji's books because they're all heavily underlined. Lot of remarks are there, where he agrees, where he disagrees, where something reminds himself of something else, questions he has got. Everything he puts down. Now imagine the kind of involvement in that book. The Bhagavad Gita also says this. In one chapter, Sri Krishna asks Arjuna, be completely concentrated on God. So I'm sure, just like you, Arjuna would have scratched his head. Then he says, "Atha itadapi ashaktos." If you cannot do that also, then whatever work you are doing, you connect it, you offer it to me. So the daily work which you are doing, you're studying, your work in the kitchen or your work in the office, you offer it to God. You're connecting your daily work to God. Now you see how concentration, he's helping concentration by involving other things in the world. Swami Abhedanandaji, one of the disciples of Sri Ramakrishna, I read a reminiscence by a young person He said, when I was young, I used to go to visit Swami Abhedanandaji, and he would meditate. He was quite old at that time, and I would see he would meditate, you know, he would sit for meditation, he would rock his body back and forth a little bit, then as if he's a stone statue, he will sit, and that's it. 3 hours later, he'll open his eyes, like a rock he's sitting. And this boy, he would ask, Swamiji, within 2 minutes I get bored. How can you sit like this without moving at all for 3 hours? And he would joke. In Bengali, he would say, Budo Shadur Dhyan Kina. I'm an old monk, I've been meditating for so many years. But it is this thing, ability to pull everything out from the world and put it on the object of meditation. Swami Vivekananda, it was natural for him. In New York, he used to go for lectures, and in those days, he would have trams, and or in San Francisco, I think. And he would go on the tram, and he would get so absorbed in his thoughts, the tram would take the entire circuit of the city and come back more than once. And he would be ashamed of this, you know. He would say that, oh, you have to remind me, I have to go for the class. That concentration, tremendous concentration, was absolutely natural to him. There are so many stories about that. And that focus, dharana is focus, dhyana is unbroken concentration, deepens into, let's call it flow. Let's call it a higher kind of flow. So here, I'm breaking it up again. Moral life, disciplined life, good posture, deep breathing, regular breathing. Don't be like a, you know, boiler. Regular breathing. Withdrawing from the world, remember the snake. Then, dharana, holding on the focus. Then, unbroken focus, flow. This is what our Patanjali Yoga also has to say about concentration. This is one key idea. Let me just sum up by going back to this idea. Remember, you have 126 bits per second, and you have to use that to get concentration or flow, and it's always a function of matching your challenges and skills. Whenever you are out of flow, and the characteristics are there, you'll be bored or you'll be under strain. Whenever you are out of flow, you increase the challenges or the skills as the need may be. These are the basic principles. I think I'll conclude here. We have run out of time also. Thank you very much. True. Clear goals. You have to have clarity about the goals. Swami Vivekananda puts it very beautifully. Make sure what your end is, goal is. Then he says, forget the ends and concentrate on the means. Our main problem is, we are too focused on the grades and getting the IIT degree, you know, and then getting this high paying job, big pay packet and all. If you keep that in mind most of the time or all of the time, then you are not focusing on what is in front of you. That will happen. If that is your goal, keep it there. But don't keep on thinking about it. It's no use thinking about it. Once you have set up the goal, Swami Vivekananda says, you forget the goal. What it says here is, clear goals are necessary for flow. If your goals are not clear, you will always be in anxiety. You will be anxious. If you don't know exactly what you are doing at this moment, you will not get that flow. It's one characteristic of flow, that a certain amount of inner clarity has to be there, what I am doing. But the eventual goals, you should keep them in the background. Fix it, keep it in the background. There seems to be a deep connection between mental purity and concentration, deep concentration. You will say that that's not necessarily so. We know many brilliant people who lead wayward lives, but they are very brilliant. True, but you see, there again, if that person had a more pure mind, I would say his work would be even more brilliant. It's a hypothesis, but it seems to be like that. I mean, a lot of people, in your personal experience also, you see, if you have a clean life, an uncomplicated life, you can actually concentrate much more easily on your work. It's that simple.
Question?
Yeah.
ये आपने
पॉइंट आउट नहीं
कराया कि मुझे पूछा है कर्म करो और फल की
इच्छा ना
करो
इसमें कितने परसेंट सच्चाई है इस सेंटेंस में कर्म करो और फल की इच्छा ना करो ये
कैसे पॉसिबल होता है ट्रू ट्रू यस आई विल टेक अ
फ्यू मिनट्स टू आंसर दिस
देयर इज सम चंक हियर यस या इट इज चंक थैंक यू
So, when we want results, what is mentioned, what is actually
spoken about in the Gita, when you say you have, do your work and don't ask for results, it means results for ourselves. And that's okay, because most of us, when we mean results, currently fall, we mean fall for ourselves, results for ourselves. Now, the traditional idea was, what do human beings want? Life. Is there a life for this? Yeah, okay, thank you. Kama, artha, these are two things. Kama would mean pleasure. Any kind of sense pleasure. You want to party and make merry and all that, that comes under kama. Any kind of sense pleasure. From having a rasgulla to listening to very refined classical music, that's also kama, pleasure. Artha, money, an IIT degree, a big corporate pay packet, whatever. Money, success, awards, head of the department, whatever. So all of that comes under artha. Now these are what people want instinctively. What people want instinctively. What religion, any religion, will tell you is both of these have to be regulated by dharma. Dharma means morality.
Not unlimited artha and kama. They follow the rules of society, they follow the rules of decency, of morality, of law. To as much as possible they do, to more or less they did do that. There will be a very few people, small section of society, few people who would like to chase artha and kama, money and pleasure, to the exclusion of any decency or morality. It just will not get caught by the police, but through whatever means I will earn money and I will, they have a term, you know, I will what, freak out. Like have a, like enjoy life, whatever I want to do I will do. And this kind of category, you know, who just want these two, artha and kama, there is a term in Sanskrit called pamara. Pamara means an instinctive, a lowest uncultured kind of person, an instinctive life. Instinctive life. What I want it just now. I want it just now. And this kind of life actually leads to unhappiness. Not only unhappiness, even modern psychology shows that this kind of life, such people, they do not go on to achieve much in life also. But because they cannot resist, they cannot control themselves. The kind of sacrifice you need to come to IIT, for example. Many of your classmates did not have that control. So you had to sacrifice quite a bit to slog, you know, to put in that kind of work to be here today. And that's because these desires you had to rein in to some extent. Immediate gratification, no. Let me work hard, I will get more of this later on. So some amount of control is necessary. So those who have all three, dharma, artha, kama, you know, normally when we speak about artha, kama and dharma, what is the phrase? We never say kama, artha, dharma. We normally say dharma, artha, kama, moksha. So you always say dharma first. Dharma does not mean only religion, morality and everything. All three if you have, then the term which we use is a vishayi person, a worldly person but who is good. Vishayi normally has a bad connotation, that he is a worldly person. But actually dharmika vishayi, person who is good, moral. You see, most people in the world are like this. They are good, they are not evil people, they are not law breakers. But they want worldly things and they want to do it within the bounds of common good sense and morality. Now, beyond this also, there are people, the term would be moksha or spirituality or whatever. There's a certain group of people, they need not be sadhus or sannyasis, Anna Hazare or somebody like that, who is actually genuinely in it for welfare. He wants good for the society. Mahatma Gandhi. If he wanted, he could have been the Prime Minister or the President for life, if he lived long enough. But he did not want it at all. But he wanted the welfare of Indians. Why Indians? He wanted everybody's welfare. Whoever came into contact with him, even the Englishmen who came into contact with him. So such people, they are in this category. What they do is, they do not want these two. But they base dharma and this moksha, spirituality. Based on dharma, they want spiritual realization. Mahatma Gandhi says in one place in his autobiography, My Experiments with Truth, many people think that I am a politician, some say I am a freedom fighter, but what I am is actually a man, a simple man in search of God. I am doing it through politics, freedom fighting, but I am in search of God, that's all I am. That's his own idea about himself. So they don't want these two, and you can see it in their lives. They reject it when they have no interest in these two. Such people, they work without any desire for results. Which results? These results. What are these results? Personal gain and personal enjoyment. They don't want it. But they do seek something, which is the welfare of everybody. So Swami Vivekananda, many great saints, they have worked for the welfare of others, and they really don't want anything. And you know, I'll tell you just one small thing. Many people, many of you will say that, oh, that's so tough, what a great sacrifice. If you ask them, it is no sacrifice at all to them. It's no sacrifice at all to them. They would not be doing anything. What is a sacrifice? I want to do that, I cannot, I'm not doing it, I'm giving it up, and then I'm doing something. So a mother who could have a very good career in the corporate sector, she gives up her job for her children, and she later complains that you fellows, you have no gratitude, I sacrificed so much for you, because she has the feeling. She has sacrificed something for the children, truly she has. She wanted that, she did not take it up for their sake. But in the case of Mahatma Gandhi or Vivekananda or whatever, if you ask them, oh great sacrifice you have made, they'll say, no, no sacrifice at all. Swami Brahmananda once was asked by the president of the Ramakrishna Mission, Sri Ramakrishna's disciple, Swami Vivekananda's brother disciple, and the person who became the first president of the Ramakrishna Mission, he was once asked, oh Swamiji, you have sacrificed so much, you have given up everything for God, you are a great Tyagi. And Swami Brahmananda bowed down to that man, I bow down to a greater Tyagi. So why? You have given up the diamond for a piece of glass, you have given up God for the world, how great you are. Your sacrifice is tremendous, mine is nothing at all. So from their point of view, it's no great sacrifice. And it's not just very spiritual persons. Anybody who's doing work for others, you will think it's a sacrifice. If you ask them, they'll say, no, I enjoy it. I met a number of social entrepreneurs. And somebody was telling me, Swamiji, you have sacrificed so much. I said, no, it's not a sacrifice. I really enjoy this. If I had to do what you are doing, it would be a sacrifice for me. And I asked those social entrepreneurs, none of whom are Swamijis. And all of them said the same thing. None of them feel that we have sacrificed our corporate jobs. They had big corporate jobs. They gave that time, they came to this kind of a life. So they are actually, you know, giving up the results and doing work. It is in this sense. In this sense. Okay, I gave a fairly detailed answer to that one. Should we wrap up now? Okay, one. Okay. Afterwards.
Thanking him on behalf of entire IIT Kanpur, we have with us our Honorable Director Sir. I welcome Director Sir to say a few words and thanks from
him. Respect and convey a deep gratitude on the part of the Institute from each one of you to Swamiji. I was truly listening to him with very rapt attention, and I actually, I don't know, maybe we are videotaping it, and I would like to show this to many of my younger colleagues as to how one should deliver lectures in a class, and this is truly a model exposition as to how one should deliver a lecture. In fact, I must share with Swamiji my own experience. I joined this place just about a little over a year back, and by the time I finished one semester, I certainly was getting extremely bored, in true sense of being bored. And then I decided that no, I'll go back to my old profession, the true profession, which is teaching. And I started teaching again, and I continue to teach now. Somebody was saying that, why are you taking this extra pain? And my honest answer was and is that I derive my strength from teaching. Whatever I do, whatever we do, everything and anything, you need conviction to stand on it. And I derive my conviction, my strength from being truthful to my own profession. And watching him deliver his lecture, I was truly all the time wondering that why would a student ever complain about a class or a lecture if he listens to a lecture which is truly in the highest form of flow like this. So I certainly see what exactly he was talking all along. I saw a true reflection of that. So I again pay my very deep respect, and on behalf of the Institute, I would like to express our gratitude and would request you to come back whenever possible, share your time and your knowledge with us. We all basically in this setup, in this academic setup, all that we do is to pursue knowledge, and we have only one objective, which is to either disseminate or share knowledge or try and generate new knowledge. It's not very easy to generate new knowledge. We write many papers, we give many lectures, but then essentially we try to pursue at least at the end of a maybe 20-page publication, at the final conclusion part, just a few words or maybe half a sentence. If that is truly a new knowledge, that's worth writing that paper. So that's exactly what we pursue. And we should always have such excellent examples before us. So thank you again.
Thank you.
I feel extremely embarrassed and sad if this beautiful conversation, interaction stops here. I seek your apology, Swamiji, because something very, very important is waiting, and I must attend to that. So I'll take leave, and but would request you to kindly come.
I request
obviously as per the situation, but the focus of this talk was each person, how each person can enrich his or her quality of experience. And how do you do that? One word answer: by flow, by concentration. Whatever your situation is, if you concentrate there on whatever you want to achieve, what is in front of you, then you get a richer experience. The principle here is how much you concentrate and what you concentrate on. Just now, in this place, you know, how much you are concentrating and what you are concentrating on. So there are so many things here. Here is a lecture going on. Also, in your mind, there will be that I've got such and such things to do next. Now, if you are concentrating on that, then your experience will be one of restlessness.
You like and you are concentrating on that and you are thinking about it and how to apply it in your own life, you are getting a richer experience in the same environment. You understand? There are many elements. What will I pick out of that and how much I can concentrate on that? That will make your experience very rich. Absolutely. Yes. But that what we have seen, you know, so many stories of young boys and girls coming from very tough backgrounds, poor people, educationally disadvantaged, and struggling and making their way up, maybe coming to IIT and other places. You know, Anand Kumar gave a talk there, Super 30, and how so many disadvantaged children are making it here to this campus and other campuses and doing well, not only academically, even people who are physically challenged, and they're doing so well in some areas of life. So from a very tough background, one can do well, not necessarily that they will do well, mostly don't, but they do well. And again, just the opposite, from very privileged backgrounds, how many, especially teachers, I've been a teacher for more than 20 years, we've known how many boys and girls from very privileged backgrounds, parents are highly educated, they are well off, and they have got every facility, and it completely spoiled their lives. So the background is important, but what is important is what you make of that background. And how do you make something of the background? By choosing what to concentrate on and how much to concentrate on. There's a, I'll end with this. Milton, the famous English poet, he says in one place, "The mind in its own place can make a heaven of hell and a hell of heaven." The mind in its own place, the mind by itself, the mind by itself can make a hell of heaven and a heaven of hell. How? By this method, by what you are concentrating on in your environment and how much you are concentrating there. So those boys and girls from very tough backgrounds who made it to, suppose to IIT, if you ask them, they had extremely, you know, disheartening circumstances in their life, but they had one area, their studies and how it will open up better avenues in life. And so they picked that element to concentrate on and they ignored everything else. I've seen people, young boys and girls, completely depressed, mental breakdown. Why? Because they had some genuine problem in life. It may be a relationship problem, maybe a health problem, maybe a grades problem, whatever. And what did they do? They concentrated totally upon that. They will say that, no, how can I not concentrate on that? It's pulling my attention. It is not pulling your attention. It's a conscious decision. If your default setting is that, you will be pulled into that depression, into the cycle of depression and, sadness and failure and misery. But it's a conscious decision. That setting, it's not a fixed setting. You can change the default setting. You can actually consciously choose what you're going to think about and how much you're going to think about that. Okay, and tomorrow we'll take it up after the class. Tomorrow and day after, the classes, the lectures will be very different, not like this. They're going to be very serious, concentrating on Vedanta, very advanced Vedanta. So I'm not discouraging you, I'm setting up a high challenge for you to get into flow. Do come. Thank you.